Good evening, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much for joining the session, the first factual entrepreneurship session under Sci Chronicle. To people who are new to the sessions of Sci Chronicle, so we are a very new organization which primarily focuses on taking a lot of scientific facts to the community. Basically, it is science for everyone. So we conduct a lot of preliminary sessions and workshops in order to take a lot of scientific facts in a more easier manner to all people, not only people who are from science background. So with this very short introduction about who we are and what we do, I would like to introduce the speaker for today, J. Sagaya John Paul. He is currently a Ph.D. research scholar at Center for Advanced Studies in Botany, University of Madras. He is currently working in the taxonomy and ecology of freshwater microalgae from the districts of Tamil Nadu, which is funded by Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. His purpose of research is to visit all the freshwater bodies of the state and document the occurrence of microalgae and the water parameters. So with this very short introduction, thank you, John, for accepting our invitation. Now the forum is yours.
Thank you, Ms. Harini. First of all, I would like to thank Sci Chronicles for having intimated me about this program. And also I would like to thank Ms. Harini and Shailvi for intimating this to me. Am I audible? Can I get into the presentation?
Yeah, yes, you can proceed.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Is the presentation visible to everyone?
No. Yes, sir. Now I can see it.
Oh, thank you. Yes. The story of pond scums. Every story has ups and downs, right? And every story has a protagonist, an antagonist, and a story will deal with the history or the present. Just like that, the hero of a story, the protagonist, has been the biggest support for human race for years, helping the society in various aspects of the life. Our hero has been serving tirelessly. Even now, he didn't give up, or he doesn't seem tired. With every challenge, he came out stronger and benefited the common man. Do you ask how many years he has been serving since ancient times? Well, since ancient times. Yeah, he's not a vampire. Our hero is none other than a small microalgae from a pond, from a small pond, initially recognized as scum. I welcome you all to the story of pond scums. To get in with the presentation, this story of pond scum, along with Sci Chronicles, it's a factual entrepreneurship training. So this presentation will basically deal with the basics of microalgal identification, collection, and how do we mass micropropagate it. And also, it will deal with mass micropropagation of one particular microalgae. And this concept can also be implemented to other microalgae as well. And then if you are planning to start a small algal enterprise, what are the basic things that you will have to cover? So this will be the basic motto of this presentation. To start with a quick story. So I spoke about the protagonist, right? So the history says about him. During the Aztec Emperor Montezuma period, aging back to 1467 to 1520, this Emperor Montezuma, he was fond of fresh fishes. So he used to send his messengers from his capital to Gulf of Mexico, which is now called as Mexican City. So these messengers used to travel around 400 kilometers. And during that travel period, they used to carry a green slim mold with them, which is called as spirulina. Yes, the protagonist of today is spirulina. So these lone warriors who are like the group of Mayas and Toltecs, they carried this spirulina along with them. They used to eat the spirulina cakes, which gave them the endurance traveling a long time. And during that time, this spirulina was called as Tikutelak. So during that period of Montezuma, this algae was predominantly used. And it's quite evident that spirulina was a predominant primordial food. Even before we discovered its components and uses, people around the globe have started using it for its healing and performance. So soon after the Aztec emperor period, this spirulina, it disappeared due to Mexican conquistadors. So after which, in late 1940s, along the shore of Lake Chad, the tribes of Kenembu were found harvesting some kind of blue-green algae and selling it in the market. So this is a picture of the Kenembu tribes, where they collect the microalgae from the nearby pond, and then they dry it in sunlight. So after drying, they just make it into cakes and then sell it. During this Kenembu tribes, they call it as Da'i. So they believe that this spirulina has saved the Kenembu tribe and the children from against malnutrition during the period of famine. So it shows how evident spirulina was used for the livelihood. So this is not just an history. This gives us a gist about how these microalgae were identified and how they were collected and how they were processed. So we just have to take a few points from this history. That is the three basic criteria, that is collection, identification, and how to process it, how to use it for the benefit of mankind. So for any microalgae, collection, identification, and cultivation, there are a few basic things there where you'll have to check out. To start an algal enterprise, you just need to understand the basics of microalgae. Only then, if there is some trouble happening, you should be able to troubleshoot, right? So you cannot hire a scientist E or D to troubleshoot the problem at times. So you need to understand the basic things when you are about to start an algal enterprise. The first slide deals with the collection. So you don't need a special task force for collection of any microalgae. So this is a video clip of microalgal collection places. This is a video. All right, I'm not able to play the video thing. So the collection site is very important when you try to target any kind of microalgae. So this is a place in Mettur. So a stagnant water body or ecosystem is called as lentic zone, whereas the flowing water is called as a lotic ecosystem. So in lentic ecosystem, the peripheral region of the pond does have a lot of microalgae. Here you can see this old man. He collected this microalgae for me. He used to row himself in this small boat, and then during afternoon he used to drink the water. And surprisingly, when I examined the microalgae which is present in the particular pond, which these local people consume it. They drink that water for their drinking purpose. They take that water for drinking purpose. So that the algae which was present in there was microcystis, which produces microcystin, which is also a neurotoxin. So if it is taken in abundance by any livestock or pets, it will eventually lead to death, a high mortality rate. So a collection site is very important for anyone who goes for collection. So, yeah. This is a dam in Erode. This is Bhavani Sagar Dam. You can see a slight change in the color of water. It's because of industrial effluence. So it's not just about freshwater areas, it's about contaminated areas as well. These microalgae are completely diverse, and then they are completely distributed in all areas of freshwater. Though the water is contaminated or the water is not contaminated, the presence of microalgae defines the type of ecosystem. So this is also one of the places where you can collect a diverse group of microalgae. This is placed in Erode. So areas like this, they are filled with diatoms. Diatoms are species which belong to Bacillariaceae members. So they are predominantly found in places where the sand is rich with silica. So this is the places where diatoms are rich. So if you are looking for any diatom species, these kind of places will favor you a very good collection of diatoms. I just had videos for projecting. I think it is not working. So this in particular is not just contaminated water. It is a textile dye effluent. So you could see patches of blue-green in the slide, which denotes presence of cyanobacteria. So these cyanobacteria are a group of microalgae which grows in places which is enriched with inorganic carbon. For a lot of industrial scale and for a lot of applications, cyanobacteria is it is widely used. And as said, spirulina is also one kind of cyanobacteria. So these are all the collection places which will bring you a diverse group of microalgae. But then there are collection methods. So moving into the collection method, you can collect the microalgae in small vials, or you can see it in the slide, a small kind of box. So it is very important that you should use a mesh or net with pore size of 25 to 30 mm in case if you are going to explore any kind of microalgae for your startup. You're going to start it from square one, then this is the procedure. You'll have to go for the collection site and then you'll have to process it. So the phytoplankton net or mesh of size 1 mm is commonly used for terrestrial habits, for epiphytes. You can see the third picture. There are microalgae which adheres to the rock. So if in that case, you'll have to scrap the surface of rock and then pour some water upon it and then collect the microalgae colonies. So in case of documenting new species, if in case you have collected some microalgae from some place and that microalgae it looks to be a new species, then it is very important that you document the water parameters. It's because not all microalgae grows in the particular medium. So if in case it is not growing, then you should use the same water from where you collected the microalgae. Identification. I'm not getting into too technical of identification slide because getting into too technical, it is like very complex. So I'll just give a gist about basic things which you will have to consider while you collect some microalgae. And when you find it difficult to identify what kind of microalgae it is, so this will give you a basic idea of grouping them into family. So Chlorophyceae is green algae. So like most of the microalgae will look green, but doesn't mean that they belong to Chlorophyceae members. So Chlorophyceae members are something which are like predominantly green in color, and then they have chlorophyll A in abundance, chlorophyll A and B in abundance. And then moving into Xanthophyceae members. So Xanthophyceae it is also called as yellow green algae. You can clearly distinguish between green algae and yellow green algae. Something which looks in yellow green, it is put into Xanthophyceae members. So these Xanthophyceae members are rich in xanthophylls. And next is Chrysophyceae members. These Chrysophyceae members are generally cold freshwater. They don't occur in normal freshwater. But then in temperate regions where the temperature goes below 10 degrees Celsius, these chrysophysia members are found in abundance. And then basilarophysia members. The basilarophysia members are nothing but diatoms. I told you, right? In areas of river where the sand is enriched with silica, these basilarophysia members occurs. So these basilarophysia members are actually ubiquitous in nature. They are found everywhere. Next is cryptophysia. They are mainly marine forms, and they have diverse pigmentations. They have chromatophores. I'll tell you about the chromatophores in general. So the next is dinophysia members. So the dinophysia members are completely fresh marine forms. Many of you would have looked in the news, the sea waves have bioluminescence. The sea tides, during night time, it emits fluorescence. It's because of this this group of dinophysia members. They are also called as dinoflagellates because they have the chromatophores in that layer, just like octopus, just like chameleon. The surface is filled with chromatophores which emits light when they are excessively provided with oxygen. And next form is chloromonadine. They are also freshwater, but then they are filled with xanthophylls. Their occurrence is very less. So commonly, if you go for any collection, it will be only chlorophysia, basilarophysia, cyanophysia, and eblunophysia. And the next group is eblunophysia. If you are collecting samples from any contaminated site, say drainage water, the presence of eblunophysia members are going to be very high because they are fond of contaminants. And next is phaeophysia, rhodophysia, and myxophysia. Phaeophysia is brown algae. They are not found in freshwater, but then it belongs to seaweeds. It is another domain. And then rhodophysia members are found in freshwater as well as marine water. In freshwater, rhodophysia members such as Betrachospermum or Audonilla species are found. And speaking about myxophysia, they are the cyanophysia members of blue-green algae. As said about spirulina, so these blue-green algae are the prominent species which are of commercial importance. When you have to basically identify any microalgae, this is a general criteria, but then there are a lot of monograph. A monograph is nothing but a pictorial representation of algae with its attributes. So as like you can compare your photograph with the provided photographs in the monograph to identify that will help you identify what microalgae you have collected or documented. So cultivation. Cultivation is important because when you see a plant, it develops from a seed. Just like that, a microalgae cannot be cultivated overnight. So it has to be it is a progressive procedure where for 1 liter of microalgae, you need to start with 2 ml. With 2 ml, you will have to inoculate in 10 ml. And once the algae grows in 10 ml, it has to be transferred to 100 and then to 1 liter. So cultivation. So cultivation, there are five types of cultivation and cultures. In the picture you can see. So the small vials is where I collected the microalgae from the wild environment. Once I collected the microalgae, I amended with media. The medium such as BBM or 213, BG11, it depends upon the type of microalgae. So once the culture is enriched, we go for streak plate. That is, if we take a petri plate, we amend it with the medium, and then you streak on it. You just take a pinch of colony from the test tube and then strike on the media. So you can see the pure cultures of algal streaks here. So from here, you can again scrap one colony and then you can micropropagate. That's how cultivations in a lab scale happens. So there are actually 5 types of cultures where maintenance is something like you just collect the microalgae and maintain it. Enriched culture is you enrich your culture with carbon or nitrogen for it to grow, for it to multiply in a larger rate. And then unialgal cultures are something which is only one algae And then there is a possible of bacterial or fungal contaminations in unialgal cultures. But in axenic cultures, it is devoid of any microbial contamination. A pure culture or axenic culture is something only the desired microalgae is present. Clonal culture is something which is genetically engineered, which is like conventionally or non-conventionally, it is genetically engineered. So that is clonal cultures. So why spirulina? Why do you have to speak about spirulina? Because you know spirulina is more than a fortified food. You see, a single tablespoon of dried spirulina powder contains 4 grams of proteins. So since it's a basic, it's a general audience, I would like to give a notch on what these proteins and vitamins does to our body. Protein is very important because they are the building blocks of our body. They build and repair muscles in our body. So that is why protein is important. And vitamin B1, thiamine. So this vitamin, what it does is it uses carbohydrate as energy. You know, it spreads energy to the nervous and muscle and heart function. So vitamin B1 thiamine is very important. And this spirulina has 11% of the RDA. It is regular dietary allowance. For per day, you need this much of vitamin B1 or vitamin B2. So this 1 tablespoon of spirulina contains about 11% of RDA of vitamin B1. Moving on to vitamin B, it helps break down proteins, fats and carbohydrates, and it converts that into energy to our body. Vitamin B3, it helps our nervous system, digestive system, and keeps our skin healthy. A lot of us might take vitamin B complex. So this is the purpose of vitamin B complex. And copper, what copper does is it helps in enhancing the immune system. You know, it helps in making RBC, red blood cells. It maintains the nerve cells and immune system stronger. And iron, basically we have blood, right? So blood is made up of hemoglobin, and this iron plays a vital role in maintaining the hemoglobin level. And there are also several micro nutrients which is present in spirulina. So all put together has made spirulina a huge asset to the mankind. Getting into the mass cultivation of spirulina, I'll be discussing about the procedures and the several domains which is present in mass cultivation of spirulina. So to put in a short note, inputs and carbon dioxide. For the growth of spirulina, it needs carbon dioxide. And in addition, it needs water. Water has to be amended with nutrients, and then it has to be provided with the algal stain. And then you keep it in sunlight, it proliferates. So this is the general procedure of micropropagating any kind of microalgae, irrespective of spirulina or Haematococcus or chlorella. So here in the flow chart, you know, it tells about what are the parameters which has to be seen when you micropropagate a microalgae. So when you are about to start cultivation of spirulina or any other microalgae, it generally deals with several domains. As said earlier, the cultivation cannot be done overnight. It has to be processed in a sequential way, right? So the structural profile of the cultivation center deals with installations of 4 subgroups, which is the installation of 3-meter pond. So this 3-meter pond, which will help in the initial initial growth of microalgae. From the 3-meter installation, it is taken up to 12-meter installation, and then to 100-meter installation, followed by 500-meter installation. That's how a microalgal mass cultivation is processed from a smaller scale to a larger scale. And then it is taken, once the algae is mass propagated, it is taken to laboratory, followed by drying. And the drying is of different types, where it deals with centrifuge and other mechanic and electrical maintenance. So once it is done, it has to be processed, which is done with help of compressors, receivers, vacuum, and then final storage. So this is the basic structure of any mass cultivation of microalgae center in India or is in any place around the globe. So as said earlier, it is an installation of different different domains, right? So basically, the algorithm chain, particularly what kind of spirulina strains have to be used, they choose a particular strain and then they intensify the culture, because a 2 ml culture cannot be directly taken up to a 1 liter or 1000 ml cultivation pond. So it has to be intensified. It is provided with carbon dioxide for it to intensify, and then it is cultivated in semi-production ponds. Here you can see the pipe for CO2 supply. And also, to reduce the cost, they also use water from geothermal centers. So this geothermal water, it produces heat and it is also filled with CO2. So they to reduce the cost, they use geothermal water. As in the microalgae, as said, it is intensified and then it is taken to semi-production ponds. So from semi-production pond, it is taken to the production ponds. So a production pond is something which is oval and made of concrete. So they call it as a raceway pond. The structure is oval and they have saddle wheels here. So what these saddle wheels do is they continuously stir the water, stir the media filled with this algal strain. While it stirs, it is also supplied with CO2. As I said earlier, the CO2 is responsible for the micropropagation of any for spirulina. So this pedal wheels, no, it rotates. So this agitation will ensure that CO2 is taken up by all the cells of spirulina. So that is the basic motor behind the pedal wheels and CO2 supply. And also in production ponds, every parameter it is keenly observed, because the heating of suspension, the temperature maintained is very important for microalgae. The temperature around about 35 to 38 is optimal for the growth of spirulina, and the pH is 9.0 to 10.5 is optimal pH for the growth of spirulina. And then once the cultivation is done, once the microalgae is mass propagated, once it is enriched with sodium bicarbonate and with all the pH parameter, with all the temperature, the spirulina attains a larger biomass. So once it attains a larger biomass, it has to be washed and dried, right? So for high quality spirulina, the washing process is very important. Just like the mesh, we have something like the vibration filter, where the algal culture is gone through the filter, and it during the agitation it filters, and the remaining filtrate is again sent to the production ponds, because the algal suspension shouldn't get less than 1.8 or 2.5. So 1.8 to 2.5 grams per liter. So this is the basic algal suspension concentration. So which is a PAR score for any cultivation pond. And then once it is washed, it has to be taken for drying. So during washing and drying, there are several procedures which is carried out, because while drying, this filament tend to break. But then this vacuum filters or filter centrifuge helps in maintaining the structural integrity of spirulina. Thereby, you can take 100% of the biomass for further process drying. So once the algae is taken from the production ponds, once it is filtered, it has to be dried. So there are three ways in which the microalgae is dried, the biomass is dried. One is in natural conditions. In natural conditions, just like that, in a plastic layer, it is just dried under sunlight. And next is greenhouse. Greenhouse, it is closed. It is devoid of other moist content and other dust materials. And the third is electrical resistance. Electrical resistance, it is just an auxiliary heat source which maintains the temperature to 70 degrees Celsius, which ensures that the algae is dried soon. So once it is dried, it is taken for milling and packing. The dried biomass is milled and the product is packed. So once the algal cakes are ready, it has to be grinded and milled for packing purpose. So a mesh of 60 to 80 is generally used to cut the cakes and then take it for further process. So this is a general protocol for mass cultivation of algae and how it is processed till packaged. So this is an advanced technique which deals with production of microalgae. This advanced technology is called as photobioreactors, where this is an advanced production unit. It is something like a straight transparent glass or plastic which is filled with media, and then the algae is inoculated into it. And within the production unit itself, it is provided with CO2 and oxygen. And once the algae is grown, the production unit, this bioreactors by itself, it filters the microalgae and it gives us the biomass. So this is one of the latest technology where most of the microalgal companies have deployed. This is in addition. So having said about the techniques of how you cultivate the collect the microalgae, how you identify it, and how it is taken up for mass propagation, and how it is processed. So we were generally discussing about all those. But when it comes to a startup, when it comes to an algal enterprise, how do you start spirulina cultivation commercial in India? So it is not a one-step process. The installation is not a one-step process. It is also a sequential process. So getting into that, we'll be dealing with this five things, which is the concept, finance, process, network, and target. When you're about to start an enterprise, your concept is very important. This concept defines the amount of financial support you're about to get from the finance source. And the process, how do you process it? When you're about to start up a company, the process is not as simple as it sounds. It is a complex procedure, but then when it is done in a sequential way, it is very effective. And networking, which is a very important parameter for any startup, and the target. So when all these four parameters done together in a very sequential way, you can easily achieve your target. So speaking about the concept, so when you're about to start up an algal enterprise, your concept for financial support is very important. This is just an examples of, call from companies all over the globe. They have called for proposals, research proposals, or startup concepts. The first one is UK firm buys Israeli maker of algae mimicking medical adhesives. You know, this guy, Israel, he just found that algae was adhering to a rock. And you just find out there is some substance which helps the algae to adhere to the surface of the rock. So this adhesive material, he just isolated the adhesive material and he used it for medical adhesives. So because of that concept, the deal is for $25 million. And also he was offered royalties for future sales as well. So this kind of concept is very effective. So that is why I was telling about initial identification of microalgae, because the concept and the importance of microalgae depends upon the type of microalgae you are going to work on. Not just spirulina, it is many other microalgae which is dealing with many commercial purpose. And the second one is Saudi Arabia, France move towards partnership in algal industry. So they have shown interest in developing and cultivating algal industry in Saudi Arabia. We all know that Arab countries, they are lacking in water things, and then they basically look for biofuel. So there are a lot of microalgae which are a potent a customer for biofuel production, something like botrycoccus, something like senedesmus. They are hyperlipid producing strains and can be used for biofuel production. So this Saudi Arabia, France move towards partnership in algal industries. This is oriented towards food and chemical production. And then the next is Algal Tech gains stake in Australian pharmaceutical delivery company. Again, here they are oriented towards health algae, as said about spirulina, these microalgae can also be a potent candidate for against malnutrition. So Algal Tech has agreed to pay an initial cash consideration of around I think it's 1 lakh American dollars. So just imagine your concept is going to be very vital for your financial support, and that is why I have projected these examples. And then you see algal bioethanol and biodiesel production through glycerol fermentation. Yes, there are a lot of microalgae which are, as said earlier, are hyper-producing strains. So if you are able to find potent microalgae which are able to produce biodiesel or bioethanol, then it's kind of a jackpot for you. So that is why I was mentioning about collection and identification. If you're a person who wants to again start from the scratch, collect a microalgae, but then if you're finding it very difficult to identify, you can very well send the microalgae samples to me to identification. And getting back, there is one interesting call for here. Chlorella improves quality of life in breast cancer patients. Yes, most of the microalgae are used for its antioxidant properties. Something like Clepsor medium, which produces microsporin-like amino acids. So they are generally UV repellent amino acids. So they can be an excellent source of microalgal source for pharma industry. And then the one more concept is co-culturing biodiesel producing green algae with microalgae to increase ecological stability. Yes, since we are harvesting microalgae from freshwater ecosystem, you don't need complex chemicals. You don't need toxic chemicals for the microalgae to grow. So you can generally, maintain the ecological stability, which is also a very good concept. So I would like to repeat it again. Your concept is very important before you start an algal enterprise. And here it was a proposal by the Indian government that researchers asked to give up efforts to develop biodiesel. So the lot of research institutions are working in making biodiesel from microalgae. So Professor M.M. Sharma, the senior researcher of Academy of Science, Scientific and Innovative Research, that he has given up a proposal that a microalgae can be an effective source of biodiesel. And here is a very good example. He is an Indian entrepreneur, Dr. V. Sivasubramaniam. He is a director of Phycospectrum Environmental Research Center, PERC in Chennai. As said earlier about the ecological stability, so here our professor works in removal of heavy metals from xenobiotics from wastewater. So if your place is filled with some industrial effluent, you can take the industrial effluent to professor so that he treats the effluent with microalgae, and then he reduces the heavy metals which is present in microalgae. And recently he has signed a various project with the government of Tamil Nadu in reducing the water contaminations in Chennai Adayar Kuvam. So there are a lot of projects which is taken up by Dr. V. Sivasubramaniam. So these are the concept which will rend you money. And yes, you have a concept with you. When you have an effective concept with you, you will have to approach some financial supporting agents. So there is about 8 major financial supporting agency in India. One, the first one is government thing, the Science and Technology Entrepreneurs Park. So it is an initiative of the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. So any individuals who are about to start a startup business, they can take their innovative ideas for commercialization, and with their support they can rent you around 2 lakhs to 100 lakh for your startup. So this is a government aided agency where they can give you money. And then this another agency, the Startup India. So it is a multiplayer grant scheme. When your concept is of technology oriented, something like the production unit, advanced production unit, when you have some concept related to this, then you can approach this agency, and they are giving you fund, to 24 crore, which is a huge amount for any startup. And the next is NASCOM Startup Hub. So their focus point is generally healthcare, agriculture, education, smart cities, and infrastructure, and artificial intelligence across industries. So if you're about to start up an algal enterprise, which is oriented towards healthcare or agriculture, something like fertilizers, a mini microalgae are a source of very good biofertilizers. So if you're able to find some microalgae, which is an excellent source of biofertilizer or for healthcare, then this agency is a very good option for you to approach to. And the next is Unlimited India. Here, their focus sectors is agriculture again, and livelihoods, energy, water, and sanitation. Energy, bioenergy, speaking about biodiesel, bioethanol, biomethanol, if you're able to start up an algal enterprise of this interest, then Unlimited India is an excellent source, and they are an excellent source for finance. And next is Zone Startups, which is, as I said earlier, it is technology oriented. They grant fund from 50 lakhs to 3 crore. When your startup is technology oriented, you can approach this agency. And Amrita TBI, one of the lesser known startup grants in India, but then they are a great support to entrepreneurs, and then they really nurture startups and entrepreneurs at the early stage. So when you are, not just the early stage, pre-earliest stage, you can approach them for any financial support, though it is a private sector. And then we have finished about the concept and the financial sources. When you have the right concept, when you approach the right financial agency, you get funded. So once you're funded, you will have to start your process. So this is the process. A license and registration needed for spirulina production business or any kind of microalgae-based production business. So this is a universal protocol for you to follow up. So apply for FSI registration in case of food related business. What does this FSI do is, like, it generally helps in process of applying loans for your business. And it also helps in your business growth. Next is trade license. This trade license, when you obtain a trade license, which makes it, legally, you are legally able to carry out various activity based on your business. So it is something like legitimacy to a company. And then the next is apply for MSME Udyog Aadhaar online registration. It is a micro and small medium enterprise. So what does this do is it puts efforts to encourage entrepreneurship, employment, and livelihood opportunity. This will also help you in for applying for some loans and for any other business growth. This is a very supportive agent. And then we all know we have to get the GST number. So registered taxpayer. So you'll have to be a registered taxpayer. And this tax operation will help you in filing and then for any refund claims or even for loan purpose. And the next is SSR registration for availing subsidies. One good benefit of SSA registration is a lesser rate of interest. When you avail a loan from any bank, when you have SSA registration for your startup, then it's going to be a very less rate of interest, and then very less electricity bills. This is more like MSME. There are a lot of benefits when you register under MSME and SSA. And before that, we have the no objection certificate from the state pollution control board. When you're about to start up a company, it shouldn't be near the residential areas. If it is near the residential areas, your startup shouldn't hinder the daily livelihood of the normal people. So it is very important to get a no objection certificate from state pollution control board. Up next is apply for BSI certificate for ISA mark and standards. So BSI is one of the world's largest certification bodies. So what does this do is, you know, reassurance. It gives you a reassurance of partnering with an independent or an international standard organization. When you have this BSI certificate or ISA mark, you know, you can easily collaborate with other companies, other international or any domestic company. It helps you, you know, it gives you the reassurance. And then the next is get VAT registration. So either voluntary or compulsory, you know, it adds a lot of benefits to the company. Something like the small business, you know, it gives the appearance of bigger and more established. Even though you start up a small business, when you have tax VAT registration, it appeals that yours is not a small body, but then it is a bigger and established company. When you had a VAT registration number in your invoice or something like that, then it is appealing to customers, vendors, investors. So that is one advantage of VAT registration. Another big advantage of VAT registration is it demands accurate records. So it also, you know, helps in running the company in a very accurate way. All those tax filing things, all those accounts details has to be very accurate. And the final thing is get brand name protected through trademark registration. So once you're done with all these, then it's time for you to name your company and get the trademark registration. So branding. So this branding, though it might seem less importance here, but then your brand is very important when you go to the next process, which is networking. So networking. I've just put in some bullet points for you to understand about how important networking is. But the networking is something which deals with connections, right? You have probably heard of this saying. It's not what you know, but who you know. You'll have to approach the right person who can help you networking, who can take your company's brand all over India or all over the world. You know, some of the people who can help you in myriad aspects, from legal to complaints, even to payrolls. So you'll have to find connections with people who are able to network your brand all over the country. And next is opportunities. So by yourself, you have the ability to generate opportunities, you know, no matter which and what business you're in. Networking will help you with a lot of opportunity to embark with. Something like when you start up a business and then you start to network it, when you start to brand it, you tend to get a lot of opportunities to collide with or either to have a partnership with. But then when you have numerous collaborations, there is something that you will have to keep it in your mind. Warren Buffett once said, the most successful people in the world are someone who has used to say no to a maximum of things. So make sure you don't jump into every opportunity that floats to you. Instead, examine carefully each and every one and then decide whether you will have to get into that or not. So once you end up taking up a partner, just make sure that they align with your vision of your career, or else you might end up with opportunity fatigue. So that is something which is important while networking. And the third one is positive influence. So the caliber of your milieu will determine how successful you can be. So it is vital for you to develop a robust networking of people who can encourage you at times. You know, positive influence is something which have to be with you when you start up a company, because at the initial time there will be a lot of negative aspects. There will be a lot of negative vibes coming into you, but then you need a positive influencer who can support you during that times. And then next is advice. Maybe probably most of you will hate advice, but then networking will offer you a cadre of like-minded owners. Maybe if you're starting up a new business, something like hematococcus, and then you end up with algal forms. Algal form is something which the growth has stopped all of a sudden. So maybe you are you know, partner can would have been in the same situation where you are now. So that particular you know, advice from them during that situation will help you turn up the business. So, which is something very important. Get advice from your partners. And then increased confidence, which is something like the positive influence. So networking is good for people who are not confident, actually. So it actually gives them a catalyst for growth by forcing them to constantly meet new people. Networking is something, you know, you will have to constantly meet new people, and then you will have to make them understand what your profile is. And then you'll have to understand what their story is, so that your partnership has to be very, you know, it has to be very good for any initial startup. And then raising your profile. When you are about to start up a business, your profile, you know, speaks about your company. Your like, just like a brand speaks about the company, your profile speaks about the company. I'm sure you are more than your LinkedIn profile, right? So regularly attending business and social events will help you, you know, go with people, and then people will start recognize you. They will start recognizing your concept. They will start recognizing your brand. So that itself is a big network. So just by knowing people, you can raise your profile and also your brand. And then friendship. Friendship might seem an unprofessional addition to networking, but then business owners need a friendship perhaps most of others, because you know, when you are utmost down, at sometimes only a good friendship can help you reconnect with the right people and take you over the line. And getting back to these bullet points, so we'll have to focus on the right people who can help you reach the target and create win-win situations. This is for the partnership programs, where it is important for both of you and other party to gain equally when networking. And then give before you receive, which is very important, that some of you might be waiting for them to respond, and some of you might be waiting, like let them start the conversation and let us give it back. So that's not how it is. So when you are about to start up, you know, you'll have to go meet people and then give them what you want to give it to them. So become a connector. As I said earlier, connectivity is very important in any network. And then remember to reconnect, which is very important. Maybe we would all have friends who can, you know, call you out of the blue, something once in like a leap year. So that's not how it is. You'll have to, you know, reconnect with people. After you choose the right people to network with, remember to stay in connect with them, even though when you have started your work, it is all proceeding. Have then and there, you know, you try to stay in connect with them, so as it doesn't make like there is no big gap between you people. And then use social networks. So now maybe you all know, we all run a YouTube channel of our own. We all have pages, Facebook pages. We have meme pages, something. So we have to make use of the social networks to the extent, something like LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter are the tools which can be used in a personal way to different people in your industry. So you can, through networking, you know, you can find domains of your own interest, and then you can have a very good partnership with them. So that's how you start your own networking group. One of the best ways to meet like-minded people and establish your own networking group. You can use meetup.com. There's some websites where, you know, startup entrepreneurs are get together. You know, they just blend in into that group, and then all of a sudden they meet, they come up with ideas, and that's how they network their own startup. So this is so these two websites are something which is very important for entrepreneurs, young entrepreneurs. Yeah, so we saw about the concept and the finance, and how do you network, and then the target, it ends up in rupees, right? So your target investment and what would be the outcome. So this is a general slide which speaks about the cost for any plantation. If you are about to start up algal mass cultivation company, so this is an estimation of how and how, what amount you will have to invest and how you will have to approach the financial agency for your investment. So for pond construction, that is for the raceway pond, it's like 3 lakhs, and plant machinery, something like the saddle wheels, something like the alkyl suspension units, which is not quite expensive, but then the lab equipments are quite expensive. But then you don't need complex lab equipment, something like the pH meter, something like the turbidity checker, something like the suspension checker. So these are the basic equipments which you will be needing. And then water treatment plant is very important, which costs you like 1,50,000. So water treatment plant, because when you harvest the microalgae, again the water has to be sent to the production unit to again initiate the harvest, so which is very important. And other all is like the miscellaneous and then piping work, electrical work, harvesting screens. So harvesting screens, like branded harvesting screens, are even more costlier because harvesting, during harvesting and drying, it is better that you close your drying area, because it shouldn't be a dusted area. It does fill the area filled with dust and other moisture. So harvesting screens are very important. And then packaging material, so it has to withstand a lot of at least to an extent of time period, because a packing material is very important when you market it, when you port it to some other place. So chemicals, there is no complex chemicals which is need for algal growth. As said earlier, there are basic media which is required for the growth of microalgae, in addition to carbon dioxide and sodium bicarbonate. So there is no complex chemicals involved. In addition to chemicals, there is also use of fertilizers which will increase the algal growth. So another thing is labor charges. So we need people who can regularly monitor the pH change, regularly monitor the temperature, and then just to monitor, and then for the drying purpose. We have the miscellaneous charges and then operational cost. So the total cost of starting a spirulina production is like 15,12,000. Estimated profit. If a person is running a production unit in the right protocol, with all those regular features ahead, then a kilogram of wet culture gives around 100 gram of spirulina dry powder daily. So when you have like 20 tanks, it's like 4 to 5 kg of spirulina daily, and for a month it is like 100 to 130 kgs. So the cost of 1 kg of spirulina in current market is 600 rupees. So a farmer, if he is about, like he can gain about 40,000 to 50,000 per month, if he is able to gain 100 to 130 kgs, exclusive of other charges. Maybe you would have, you would be paying for some other purpose. So irrespective, and if there is some loss because of algal foam formation, or there is no proper growth of microalgae, then you'll have to revamp it again, troubleshoot what the problem is, and then get back to the initial stage, and then multiply it again. So exclusive of all that, a farmer can gain about 40,000 to 45,000 per month. So this production differs from region to region and also depends on many factors. So production unit cannot be asset set in a place. It depends upon the region, because something like Chennai, the drying can be done in a natural conditions during the month of May and April, May. But then in something like other regions, some temperate regions, it cannot be done the same way. So it differs from region to region, and also many factors are involved in it. I didn't cover up the factors which influence the production of microalgae. Maybe if people are interested, you can mail me on that. So the conclusion is like, you can look at the right side. Not just spirulina is a potent candidate. We have other microalgae as well, that is chlorella. Lot of works has been done in chlorella. And the next is another green algae, Haematococcus pluvialis. It is called as king of antioxidants. A lot of cosmetic and pharma industry are running this production unit for them to make cosmetics, to make anti-aging cream, to make anti-aging tablets. It is also available in India. And the next is third one is Clepsol medium. I told about the UV repellent amino acid, right? So this Clepsol medium is an excellent source of MAA, and a lot of pharma industry is running based on Clepsol medium. And one important thing I would like to give it to the audience is, like, our India is buying this Clepsol medium strain from US for so and so crores. So this strain is not so far available in India. So if it is possible, if anyone is possible, if we were able to isolate such kind of microalgae, then it would be a potent source for us to start up our own business. And the next is Botrycoccus. So it's an excellent source for bioethanol and biodiesel production. So it's not just about spirulina, a lot of microalgae are there. And one more important thing is there are a lot of microalgae which is still unexplored. So that is why I would like to repeatedly insist on collection. If you're able to collect it again and come up with a potent microalgae, then it's going to be an excellent source for you to start up your own business. So one can easily make profit in spirulina powder production with a proper spirulina business plan. A business plan is very important for you to end up with a profit zone. If any plans to grow spirulina commercially, one can reduce input cost and increase profits in production of spirulina powder business through proper optimization. As said, you can reduce the input cost by using some source of water, just like the geothermal. You can use biofertilizers for increasing the spirulina growth. So when you start up your own business, maybe you will know to troubleshoot the problems, and then you can increase or double up the production of microalgae. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, John, for your great presentation on algae and starting an complete enterprise from microalgae. So now the session is open for questions. You can either post your questions in the chat box, or please feel free to unmute and ask your questions. I'm just sending the link for feedback form. Please do fill the form, and thank you so much. John, there is a question. What about the anti-contaminating agents?
Anti-contaminating agents. So first thing about contaminations is, like, what kind of contamination is happening in your production unit? It can be some other microalgae, it can be a bacteria, it can be a fungal contamination. So it depends upon the contamination. It's about the contaminating agents. So that is why I prefer the closed unit. When you have a closed unit, then you can something like the outer atmosphere, which is filled with bacteria and fungal spores, it is a contaminating agent. And if at all there is contamination, you can increase the concentration of sodium bicarbonate or NaCl. So increase in the chemical agent will definitely help you against this contaminating agents.
Any other questions?
Can you suggest any other microalgal production with less investment? Yes. There is in Navalur, Chennai, there is a group of Sri Lankan refugees. They have started microalgal production in just the small wells, something like 2x4 well, which is a very less investment. They are just harvesting spirulina in a very small scale and then giving it to a local market for it to be processed and for any other application. So yes, it can also be grown in fish tanks, something like that, and then for your beneficial, it can be done. And yes, any other microalgae, something like chlorella, can be grown in a very less investment way. I think I'm clear with that. Yeah.
John, there is a question from Saumya. When should we go for collection? Which season?
Yes. Again, it depends upon the place. In
in place like Tamil Nadu, you'll have to go after monsoon, which is very important, because only after monsoon the spores will be germinating and you can collect diverse group of microalgae. So it is recommended post monsoon collection is the effective time for microalgae collection. How do we grow and symbiotic algae? Growing symbiotic algae for something like for our beneficial or for large scale production, we don't recommend symbiotic algae for large scale production. But there are a lot of symbiotic algae in family of ketophorals where Udogonium, a family of bulbocates, they grow along with other unicellular microalgae. So it naturally occurs, but then if you're growing symbiotic algae together, then you don't know which compound is being produced, synthesized by which microalgae. So we don't recommend symbiotic algae for mass production. So how do we know the algal cell is pure? Is there any cost-effective testing method? Yes, it's a very simple method. You just need to take the algal suspension and observe it in the microscope. There will be a lot of morphological changes because, say, spirulinite is spiral in shape, and if at all there is chlorella contamination, then you can see oval-shaped colonies with flagella. So it means that your algal culture is contaminated with chlorella or any other microalgae. So it is a microscope is enough. So it is a very cost-effective testing method. Will same species contamination be considered as a contamination? Actually, yes, it is, because if different strains of spirulina produces different amount of phycocyanin. So it is very important that you stick to species contamination. Species contamination can seem to be it's of not important thing, but then a species contamination should also be considered as contamination. It will influence the biomass productivity. So effective way for avoiding same species contamination. Yeah. I said about the semi-production pond, and before that you will have to intensify your culture. That is the reason I said you will have to intensify your culture. When you intensify your culture with the same species, the algal culture by itself intensifies. So during that stage, you actually eliminate the contamination of other species. So that is the reason intensification of algal culture is very important prior to semi-production and production unit. So that is the procedure.
Is there any other question?
So how do you store these different algal species for a long scale? Cryopreservation is one method, and then algae are live cells, and you cannot you will have to maintain the culture. So you will have to subculture it every then and then. Only then you can keep the algal culture in active state. It shouldn't the general growth period for algae is 15 to 21 days, after which it goes to decline phase. So you will have to subculture your microalgae in every 15 to 21 days, which makes it effective strain to take it to large scale production. You'll have to just store it in the media itself.
Is there any other question? Please feel free to put your question forward.
Can you see any valuable products currently in the market? Yes, as I said earlier, products from Haematococcus pluvialis, a temperate microalgae. There is a lot of an anti-aging cream. Maybe I can post it up later. There is
producing it in one brand name. I don't remember the brand name, but then anti-aging cream, anti-aging tablets, Spirulina capsules, Spirulina tablets are also in the market currently. And even chlorella tablets as well. So any product which comes into the market, it would definitely undergo clinical trials. Though there might be an addition of excipients and other storage units, but then the clinical trial will ensure that there is no side effects. So I think there shouldn't be any side effects if they have undergone the right clinical trial procedure.
Hello, sir. This is Soumya here.
Yes.
I just have one question. For example, if we are planning on specifically on say a micronutrient or any specific compound from the microalgae for our food use or medicinal use, what is the best way to extract?
So yes, for extraction, it is another domain. Just like that, if you are able to use your biomass, then it's completely a conventional way. But then if you're going for extraction of a particular compound, then chromatography, something like HPLC, it deals with solvents. I think chromatography, initial chromatography technique will help you find which is your a compound of interest, your desired compound. So that proportion will help you separate that compound when you harvest the algae in a large scale. So once you optimize the conditions for separation of your compound, then you can grow the algae in a larger scale, after which you can follow the same process for the separation of your particular compound. So that's how it is. So initial optimization is very important. Initial screening is very important. Maybe at the lab scale. Hope I was clear.
Okay, so if there is no further questions, I would like to thank you, John, for accepting our invitation on a very short notice and giving a very detailed talk on how we could culture an algae and how that can be a source for entrepreneurship. So thank you so much, and thank you everybody who have joined this evening. So this session has been recorded, and we'll post the recorded YouTube link of this session very shortly in the WhatsApp group. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you. Have a good evening.